Yo, welcome to the Smoke Break Podcast. It's your boy Anthony here, Monte, Jordan, and today we have a great special guest, Senator Gerald Neal, Democrat here in Kentucky, District 33. We're honored to have him here.
Welcome.
You've been a senator since 89. And, you know, we know 2020 is a big election year. And we just, you know how we do here at the Smoke Break Podcast, wanted to come to the table and talk about things that people in the community are talking about.
Okay.
And first off, how's it going for you today?
Pretty good. You know, it's a holiday season. In fact, it's my favorite. Okay. Christmas just rolled past us a little bit. Got New Year's coming, so it's looking hopeful.
Can't complain about Christmas. I hope it's even though it's 66 degrees. On Christmas.
I love it.
I love snow, but boy, I'm glad it was warm this Christmas. For some reason.
Because we didn't want to move around.
Exactly. So, you know, I mean, I know your time's valuable, so we get straight to it.
Okay.
Like I said, we're the Smoke Break Podcast, so we are advocates of marijuana getting legalized, whether it's medically, recreational. Our preference would be both. But, you know, we know, especially being in the industry of CBD, how important it is, even if it's just medically legalized. Mm-hmm. So the session's beginning next month. What are you looking forward to as far as any issues addressed in any sessions?
Hey, you don't want to talk about legalizing marijuana, right? You're talking about all the issues.
I mean, overall, what are you looking forward to? What issues are you looking forward to address?
Well, I'm going to tell you, the big policy issue always is the budget.
Okay.
And that's this is going to be a tough year. It was a tough year last year. Tough year before. In fact, it's been tough years for a while now. And part of that was brought on by our pension crisis. And before that, we had a dip in terms of the income that the state was getting in to take care of the services that it has to support. So even though the income has increased, it went so far into the hole that it's created a significant crisis for Kentucky. For instance, our pension obligations, our future pension obligations, are in the billions. Some say it's somewhere between 35 and 60 billion, depending on how you look at that. And the legislature, of course, has to address that. And it has been trying to address that, but that's going to be a continuing problem. So the effect on local budgets, local income, the effect on what we can do in a given legislative session is very tough. On top of that, you got all these competing things. You know, you got things that the criminal justice system requires, health, Medicaid situation, and so forth. You have education. I mean, they take big bites, and all of them are in great need. So we're going to have a very tough session as it relates to that. So that's the budget. I mentioned the pension, so we're still going to have to work on doing better in terms of trying to find a pathway to a healthy economy, I mean a healthy pension system. At the same time, we have to develop a healthy economy. That means we have to invest in economic development initiatives and perspectives. On top of that, we have to maintain and elevate education because we know that's the key to it all, that's the future. You know? So we're gonna have to continue our investment there, and not just on the P-12. Some people refer to it as the K-12. Now they say it's the P-12, mm-hmm. preschool. But on the post-secondary level as well. Yes. So, and I mentioned the criminal justice system. These are the big ones, but there are a lot of others.
Yeah, it sounds like just the little snippet you gave sounds like a lot already.
Yeah.
You know, and it gives me the question of, you know, when you know it's a lot every year, year in and year out, how are you all able to balance out the lot and get the most efficient things done for the people in the community? I know it's got to be hard to be able to, like you said, education is important, the pension is important, health insurance is important, and like people like us in the cannabis industry and everything else, what do you all do to come to some type of medium ground? To be able to get everything
done. Excellent question. What that means is we can't meet all those obligations at the levels that all people expect. because we have to have new revenues, obviously, to do that. Which brings up the discussion of cannabis, not just cannabis, but gaming and other forms of new revenue. And of course, they have addressed these in one form or another through the years, but it's always met with skepticism or significant pushback. Mm-hmm. So even that's difficult in that regard. And then you got another issue. You have some people that feel philosophically that the government shouldn't do but so much. And their thing is a cut. Well, you know, the private sector, the faith community ought to take care of that. So, you know, where is that balance? And I think you raise a good question there. And that's the nut we have to crack each time we go back. And it's always an imperfect result. But that's what the job is about. So it's a very difficult environment.
I can only imagine. Like you said, as far as the economic development, I know you're already aware of other states that's legalized marijuana and the benefits that it's had on the taxation of marijuana and the licensure of marijuana. Wouldn't that seem like a no-brainer when it comes to the economic development, especially somewhere like here in Kentucky, which was the original hemp capital of the country?
What's now hemp and what people think about when they think of marijuana is not exactly the same, as you know.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
but at the same time, I think you make a good point again. The question as to do that or not on an economic basis, I think it's easy for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I think the problem is that there's another side of the coin that some people feel. For instance, they feel that what they're doing in Colorado and Washington and Oregon and some other states, that it's going to loose a problem in the state health oriented, because they don't know all the long-term effects, they say, of marijuana. I mean, I don't know, and you don't necessarily know, but then again, they rushed out there and put liquor on, on the scene.
Right.
So, you know, at some point, you know, you keep using the word balance. I don't think there's perfection out there, but I think there's enough, at least in terms of my research, information to suggest that there is at least some good here. You can't just say this is all bad. There is some good. I think it's demonstrated.
I think so too. I think it's like you said.
Yeah, it's. I don't know that. For me, that feels. It just feels like a cop out for them to say that's the reason for them not wanting to legalize it, because they know the effects of tobacco. Like that. I don't know how long tobacco and marijuana has been present in society, but I. The little piece we know that tobacco causes cancer, and we don't know anything marijuana. Like, is it gonna get to a point where they just go ahead and push it? Like, you think this is our time, or?
Well, you know, I think clearly there's movement. It's clearly there's movement. You don't have the federal government jumping in, and even though there are still laws on the book.
Mm-hmm.
They could allow them to come into a particular state in violation of federal statutes, but they don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
There are states that have gone ahead, notwithstanding the federal government's position or the reticence of some people with respect to marijuana, but the fact of the matter is that Colorado went right ahead, mm-hmm. and they're doing what they're doing, for good or bad of it, you know.
Right.
And I think that you look at Canada and some of the other places, they're gonna be way out ahead in terms of this piece. So we better get our act together and figure out what we're gonna do. But from my standpoint, it's about finding new sources of revenue.
Yeah.
But there's another part, particularly if you deal with the medical side. I think there's enough, or at least the sources that I'm reading suggest that there's enough basis for medical use of marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is something that clearly is I think it's right on the cusp. And I think right behind it, of course, unless they can find a stronger reason to object to it, you're probably going to end up with recreational marijuana permissions mm-hmm. around the states increasingly.
That's what we're looking forward to. And I like what you're saying. And I think, like you said, it's more so the economic development, but in the medical marijuana aspect, that's where, you know, our business, Kentucky Soul CBD Company, that's what we are really intrigued and interested in, because we have clients, customers that come to us that's dealt with cancer, dealing with cancer symptoms, spinal injuries. Our son's four years old is diagnosed with epilepsy. So, you know, a lot of these things hit personal to us, and we are able to see the benefits of it, you know what I mean, like right in front of our eyes. And like you said, I'm sure you already know, the people that's telling you the stories of how much good that it's doing for people, there's no question that it's working.
Yes, I'm sorry, it wasn't a question, but I think you're absolutely right. I don't use CBD, but I know people who do, people close to me. And although I have been very skeptical, quite frankly, testimony from some of these people that are close to me who are very skeptical people, it sort of demonstrated to me there's value there.
Yeah, definitely. Michelle, I thought you were about to say something.
No, I was, but I can go ahead and ask it. So, speaking of marijuana, and, well, I guess we'll say, well, speaking of that, and the goal of legalization, do you think that's a realistic goal, and how far out do you think it will be before we reach that goal?
Well, I think medical marijuana has a chance. I think it's slim and none this legislative session. Mm-hmm. I'd be very surprised to see it.
Why do you think it's slim and none?
For the reasons I've stated in turn. You're in Kentucky.
Yeah.
Part of Kentucky is you got the Bible Belt. Mm-hmm. You got industries, and some say even the well, I don't want to go into that too deeply because I really don't know, but there are industries that may feel that they'd be affected by it. You got the pharmaceutical industry, the other industry. I don't know, but there's talk like that that they would don't look favorably upon that for their own economic reasons. That's something that I'd like to know more about. But also, I think because there's arguments on both sides. So if you let this camel's nose under this tent, then you know you open up a bunch of other kinds of problems with respect to that. So I think I've heard multiple arguments against medical marijuana, but I see, and when I talk to some of the legislators, I find increasingly more saying, "Hey, you know, this is, you know, at least what we can do is come up with a pilot program, and let's demonstrate what it can do, and let's see what the pros and cons are in action, as opposed to speculating on what this is." Yeah. So I think it's got a tough road. Recreational marijuana has even a tougher road in Kentucky. Now, I got to tell you this, that I have seen things that look like they're hopeless, and they pass. And I've seen things look like no-brainers, and they don't pass. So you don't know. You got to stay at it, and I think more information and education has to come about to either prove or disprove the points of those who advocate, those who are against legalization. So that's what I look for. I look for hard facts. I look for evidence. Tell me why we should not do this. Mm-hmm. You know, tell me why we should do this. So I'm still in that mode, so to speak.
And I know that you all put your heads together and y'all make things happen. But is there anything, if there's anything, that people that live in the city, that live in the community, that feel a way about this topic, is there anything they can do to, you know, to the people that's in Frankfurt, like you and everybody else? Is there anything they can do? Or is it just stuck on, it's about who y'all voted in, and you just gonna have to wait till the next election, or put the pressure on and see?
See, there you go, you're hitting it again. People think, you know, what I get elected to represent my constituents. So they go vote, and I go up there and I do whatever I can do, right? And I hopefully reflect what they want, and I do the best I can. You got to keep in mind, there's 38 senators. I'm one of 38, and there's 100 representatives and they have to agree to make a law. And so you can understand it's a difficult process. But people think that you vote and that's it. But really, the strongest thing that you can do is people should stay engaged in the process. First of all, they should educate themselves about these issues, and that's why I appreciate, and that's why I've come on the show. Because I think people need to know where I stand. They need to know about the issues that you're raising, whether they're for or against those issues. But they need to engage and need to educate themselves. They need to engage, which means if they're educated, or even if they're not educated and they want to know more, they need to contact us in Frankfort. We are what they call part-time legislators. Which means, you know, this is not only, I'm an attorney by profession, but the fact of the matter is that I need that input. In fact, all those legislators need it. So it's not even just about your legislators, it's about letting others know. And when you're engaged, they do listen to that. I have to tell you, people think that writing a letter or sending a message through the, actually the, doesn't cost you anything with phone numbers they have there. That doesn't have an effect, but I've seen many a time that it has had an effect. So it's important to engage. So yes, people should stay engaged all the time. And if you don't know your way around, then you need to contact me. That's why I'm there, to show you around, you know, to point out these issues, to provide you with that information, and to make sure that I'm listening to you, because it helps me to represent you better.
Exactly, and that's exactly why we started this podcast, because you know, we believe that there's things that us as people, especially in the Black community, need to be more involved in. But instead of me being the person that's going around casting people off for not doing it, I want to be a part of, you know, saying people just don't know, and giving a platform to relay this information. Because like you said, it's the truth. If you want marijuana legalized, if you want whatever you want from the people you elected, you have to do more than just be involved in the voting process.
You know, a lot of people don't understand the process. The process is a very difficult process. You know, people want to do what I do and others do, but this is not a walk in the flowers. this is hard work. And it depends on your relationships with other people, whether you have credibility with those other people that you're working with. It's an intricate process. It's moving parts. And for my party, the Democratic Party, it's even tougher because we're not in control. There are 38 senators, as I've indicated. There's only 9 Democrats out of 38. Now think about that. If you don't know your way around in that environment, you might as well go home.
Fish on water. That's the truth. And back to a little bit on the marijuana issue. I just want to say, like you touched on a little bit, but when it comes to marijuana, like other states have legalized it, but there's also, right before they legalized it, there was plenty of Black people getting locked up and given felonies for the same drug that companies are profiting on. And in Kentucky's situation, I could only assume that there's big companies already waiting to get on the marijuana industry, and people are still getting locked up, people are still getting felonies on them, which then cuts you out of being able to get a license in the marijuana industry. You know what I mean? So it's like, on the outside looking in as a resident, as a citizen, it's like they're trying to set us up to fail from the get-go. And it seems like it's been trying to set us up for years now. You know what I mean? So how do you feel about that? And I know HB 136 is the House bill about getting medical marijuana legalized. It doesn't address that issue enough. How do you feel about that?
It doesn't address a lot of issues.
Yeah, it doesn't address
Address that issue. It doesn't ensure that Black folks will be involved on the economic aspect or benefits of producing, marketing, whatever that bill allows them to do. A wise man once told me, you know, sometimes you can't swallow a whale in one gulp, you know, a piece at a time, perhaps. Let me say to you that I think that it's important for us to understand that marijuana and people being criminalized for marijuana, I think is not a good thing. I think it's historically has worked against people of color, particularly black people. And if I had my druthers, I would probably lean toward decriminalizing that. That's first of all. Mm-hmm. Even if we don't get into this other aspect of what we're growing and all that. Mm-hmm. As it relates to a lot of laws on the book, not just in this particular area, our criminal justice system needs, although we've made some strides in some of the areas, I think it still needs to be revisited. Mm-hmm. There are too many people in prison. There's no question. Kentucky has one of the highest, if not the highest, in the country in terms of rates of incarceration. The United States has some of the greatest rates of incarceration in the world. So, I mean, at some point you have to look at that and say, wait a minute, what are we doing with this talent? I mean, all these people are untalented. All these people can't contribute. I mean, all these people are draining on our society. I mean, what are we doing to lives? What are the policies that are adversely affecting people? I think we have to reexamine that. And for those who have been affected, and let me tell you, you know, you go out there and you do wrong, you know, there are consequences. You know, I'm not saying all the consequences are good or bad, but there are consequences, and that's the playbook that's out there, so you know that. But the fact of the matter is that, and I tell folks this all the time that try to take that hard line, I said, you know, those same folks you're talking about are going to come back and live right next door to you.
Right. That's the truth.
Or down the street, you know. And they have to have a way back into society. We got to think about what that means. Mm-hmm. You know, they pay their debt. Mm-hmm. In fact, paying the debt might need to be redefined. It may not be incarceration. It may be paying into the damaged life of someone else that you cause or something, which means you're still out here supporting your family and doing that sort of thing. They do some of these things in some European countries. Mm-hmm. And I'm just saying that it's not that these policies are not out there. It's not that they don't work in other places. It's our mindset. It's our culture. It's what we believe philosophically and what we even profess to be believed morally.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'll see where all that goes. But I think it's a struggle. I think it's something we can't just accept. I think we have to work toward doing a better job in this area.
Definitely. I like the point that you brought up about, you know, the rehabilitation of people that get put in prison or put in jail. You commit a crime, you pay the consequence, you paid your debt, you'll be able to get back. You know, I know Andy Beshear just passed the law where felonies, nonviolent felonies, can vote in the election, which is a great stride. But if you go before, you know, adulthood, I think, you know, rehabilitation in our youth is a big, big topic. And then when they do something like shutting down a juvenile detention center here in Louisville, it's like you said, it seems like that we know that there's ways to do things, but doing something like that sets everything back. It seems like we're not getting anywhere.
Doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
It does not make sense. I used to be, in my earlier life, I used to be a juvenile probation officer.
Mm-hmm.
Back in those days, we engaged with young people. Mm-hmm. I mean, we weren't just sitting behind a desk, you know, but now, you know, it passed around a lot of paper.
Yes,
and the connectivity, the, you know, the bringing folks together, educating youth, you know, that connection does not seem to be there. And I'm not talking about people in the field that do that work. I'm talking about the system.
Uh-huh.
You see, they work within a system.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, you know, what are we really doing? Because we all know that that has been, and you've heard the term, a pipeline to prison, right?
Exactly.
We have to break that up. And I don't think we're doing the best job at that, quite frankly. So we got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, we do. I agree.
Well, me personally, I want to jump off the weed real quick.
Jump off the weed real quick.
With all development going on with the 18th Street and the West End, is there anything you're looking forward to economically in the West End that is going to happen, or is there anything that you would like to happen?
I would like strong economic growth across the West Louisville, and for everybody to benefit. It's going to be tough. This is a complex piece, but I'm gonna try to simplify it. Mm-hmm. Historically, we know that poor folk, disproportionately black folk, who happen to be without in that area, is not something that happened by accident. Mm-hmm. You know, it's related to opportunity. It's related to government policies. It's related to culture in the sense of society. I'm not talking about individual cultures, you know, this ethnic group doesn't do as well as that. I'm not talking about it. I'm talking about the whole culture of our environment, you know, that governs us and sets these policies. So we've seen the outcome. Mm-hmm. Then we blame the folks that we push into that, that cuts off the vision, that cuts off the opportunity, and then what do? They go do this, that, and the other, then we punish them because they're striving to survive or to assert themselves or live with some level of dignity or whatever. I hope I'm not going too far with this.
Oh, no, no, no.
But the fact of the matter is that we have a system that militates against a community disproportionately of people, and that is heavy lifting. There has to be significant investment to do that. You can't just come and do something economic development. What you're gonna do is push folks around, displace them, and do things like that. You have to do something a lot more fundamental in the health areas, in the education areas. These are long-term type things, right? Yes, personal and responsibility and behavior is important. We collectively as a society and our own communities have a responsibility in that regard. Everybody's responsible for themselves in that regard, you know, so folks have to take responsibility. But the fact of the matter is that we've created a framework that has limited opportunity to people, and the consequences are predictable. I mean, they got people now looking at what happens, who can't read in the third grade, and projecting them to be in prison, you know, in the short number of years. Now think about that. What does that tell you? If you can do that, then you understand that there's a systemic occurrence that's happening that you can delay the foundation before you can even do that. You see, so we have to rethink what is happening, and we're gonna have to make tremendous investment. So it has to be more than that. Let me give you an example. What's happening on 18th Street is good stuff. Mm-hmm. I think. You have to see it. I think it's good stuff. I think what everybody tries to do to uplift a community, investment in it, et cetera, is good stuff. Okay? But what is empowering is the question I ask. What empowers? You know, you can hand something over, you can create all those environments, and I like them. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking for policies that empower people. Because people have to have a sense that they can do it, and then they have to do it. Because these things are in little bitty pieces. Every person, is an opportunity, is it not? Mm-hmm. And if they're not empowered, is that a missed opportunity?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So I'm looking for those kinds of policies. And then the second thing, you didn't ask this. But I'm on a mission. I'm on a mission.
He said he was going to help.
Don't let me loose now. We have tremendous talent in our community. Oh man, I've been all over. I've been all over the country. In fact, I've been all over the world. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, in our community, right here in West Louisville, we have tremendous talent. But we have one very serious problem. We're disorganized. So we have these talents not come together. Everybody's doing well in their little sphere. But they can't find that one, two, or three, or four things that we all agree with, that we drop everything to deal with those one, two, three, or four things. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be difficult to get to, but I think we got to start thinking about that. And then lastly, my friend, the way you can tell a community is weak is the level of negativism. You raised something a while ago, complaining about somebody's not doing something like that. That's a sign of weakness. That's a sign I can't do something. You should have done it, and I don't see it, and therefore it's not done. You keep on talking. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy, right?
Yeah.
No, nobody comes to me and say, what are you doing? It's rare for somebody to come to me and say, ask me, what am I doing?
Yeah.
You can tell, I'm glad to sit down and tell them. But the fact of the matter is they don't do that. But someone will say, well, what did Neil do?
Mm-hmm.
Or ask me. So the question is, how do we come together? How do we communicate in a positive way instead of negative approach? I don't see negativity raising anything up. We got to be positive. And even if we think we don't approve of someone who's trying to assert themselves, give them their room.
Mm-hmm.
Who knows what that's going to produce? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
We got to think positively. So I love it when I see young people out here doing it. I love that.
Appreciate it.
I love it. You know, keep doing it.
So how do you feel about the, what are they building down here? Sadiqua was helping raise money to build something there.
Love it. Come on. They could have done several things there.
Mm-hmm.
But that initiative prevailed.
Mm-hmm.
So now there's an opportunity to create and do something positive, right?
Okay.
Sports complex brings attention, brings investment.
Mm-hmm.
There's a surrounding investment. There's a learning piece that's associated with that. So there's an educational component. It generates, and I say this all the time, it generates hope. Every time something like that happens, it generates hope because it becomes dedicated to something that builds the community and it empowers. So I like what's happening there.
Well, you answered my question for me.
You know, like you hit on it now, we appreciate you. You know, coming out here, and like you said, we need policies that's empowering, and we need us people to be doing things for each other that's empowering to people. Because I really believe that unity is our biggest strength, and it's our biggest power to get the things that we want to get done put together. And platforms like Smoke Break Podcast, Colors Newspaper, and having you come and talking to us and breaking things down in layman terms for people to understand is a big step in going towards that direction. And we appreciate you coming out here.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate you.
No problem, man. Smoke Break Podcast. You know where we at down here. At-